Hello, I'm Markus Havner from NVIDIA. I'm a dev tech at NVIDIA working with people writing CAD software, and I'm usually trying to make their life as easy as possible, especially when using libraries. And so some people want to start to use Vulkan, and as you might have seen in the tutorial, using Vulkan in C is very verbose, and you might have issues with type safety, and you have to think about how to pass your arrays. I'm not sure how many people are using C++ usually in the applications. Hands up. Okay, a few. So we spent some time thinking about is there any way to map Vulkan, the Vulkan spec, auto-generated to C++ and make the life easier with the following goals. So we want to improve the error correction at compile time. So C++ is a lot of modern C++ is a lot about static asserts and type safety. We also want to shorten the source code if you work with the Vulkan API. At some places where we have to write 30 lines of code, we can reduce to a single line. And of course, we want to simplify error handling. So first, since we want to coexist with the C API, we introduced a new namespace for Vulkan. VK, obviously, and yeah, each and every symbol you find in Vulkan, you will also find in the VK namespace. But yeah, we stripped the VK prefixes everywhere so that you don't have to type VK twice. And yeah, this is about just pure API changes. Next is about compile time error detection. So look at the following piece of code. You might have seen something like this, and yeah. Typical errors that I've seen up to now is people forget the S-type, or they accidentally use a similar S-type, which is not the same, but yeah, you don't see it at compile time. You don't have type safety for enums and flags. So there are a few enums which are also similar with regards to naming, and you might decide to use the wrong enum, and the compiler will not tell you. Hopefully, the validation layer, if you use it. So everyone should use a validation layer during development. And finally, yeah, it's also possible if you have 20 fields that you forget to set one field. I've seen this also multiple times. So the question is, what can we do about it? So in C++ 11, we got scoped enums. The scoped enums, you get essentially type safety for enums. In normal C++, you can assign an integer to an enum in some compilers without any compiler warning sometimes. And so you can just mix those. And with scoped enums, the compiler enforces that you use only enums which match the type. You cannot just use any int. You can't also convert an enum to an int without a static cast. So it's quite safe. And for enums, we decided we are going to strip the VK prefix of the enum. The infix of the enum is basically the type, which is the name of the enum as camel case. And yeah, the suffix is the new enum name. Since some enums start with numbers, after you did your translation, we had to add some prefix. And we added the prefix for all enums for consistency. So we took E for enum. And yeah, this way, enums are type safe within the whole C++ Vulkan API. The next thing which are not type safe are flags. So if you want to specify multiple pipelines, you have to OR multiple values. And you can't OR enums because there are no integers anymore. And you have to think about something. And we figured out it's possible to write a class which accepts an enum and some internal mask type. And this one provides operations on each and every enum you need. So you can have a qflex class, which is now accepting initialization from a scoped enum, or you can use an OR, you can use a direct operator, you can do bit testing, so you can check if any enum is set. You can use not if you want to. If you want to pass an enum to some function, you can use an empty constructor, which says no bit is set. You can't use a number zero at the moment. We have an idea which might work, but we are not fully satisfied. And in the future, you will also get the not operator. It's not yet implemented, but we also know what to do. So this way you have type safe flags with all operations, or most operations you need in your life, and you can't accidentally mix up flags with something else. The next part is all those create infostructs. As said, it's possible that you mix up the S type and you have to specify it, you have to know the correct name, but it's also possible that you might miss some parameters. So we decided we create one class for each create info, which automatically initializes S info. So you have no chance to set it from the outside. We added a constructor which accepts all fields of the class. So instead of defining your class and then setting each field, you can set all values in a constructor. And in addition with the type safety, you're guaranteed that you have initialized all fields with some hopefully valid value. You can also copy those create infos, or you can set values. And finally, the create infos are compatible with the Vulkan ones. So we have the casts so that you can use some unsupported function and just choose the C handle for it. And yeah, with the changes I've described up so far, you have way shorter code. So the code on the right side does exactly the same on the left side, with the addition of being type safe and way shorter. Some people might like the initializer list for C99, which is not available in C++. We have some emulation, so if you want to use the old initializer list style, you can use a set variable name, dot set variable name, and so on, and you can initialize all your fields. But if you are using this initialization type, be aware, you are not setting all fields if you are unlucky, because we can't guarantee at compile time that you don't miss a field. So the next interesting part are handles. So up to now, the API gives you type safety, some compile time checks, but this is still not how C++ feels like. It's still C functions, a little bit more safe. So we decided that we convert the C style to C++ style object-oriented program. So for each handle, there's a class with the same name, which can be constructed from a native handle or from an internal function, and you have the standard operators, cast, and so on. You can test if a handle is valid, so you don't have to check for VK null handle. You can just say if valid or not valid. And each and every function which accepts this handle as first parameter is now added to this class. So now you can have your command buffer and just call functions on the command buffer. Which is also nice for code completion. And the next interesting part is in Vulkan, you have to pass everything as pointer. If you pass some struct as pointer, you can't create a temporary during the function call and get a pointer on it. So each of the new functions also converts all pointers to references, because for references you have temporaries. And since sometimes you might want to pass a null pointer, we added an optional class which allows you to pass null pointer for the reference, just to support this feature. And it's also interesting because if you see that there's an optional argument, you know this one is optional. And if optional is not available, you have to pass in a valid reference. And finally, we decided that we want to return values. So if you create a fence in the Vulkan C API, you have to pass a pointer to the variable which should contain the fence. So you have to declare the fence first, and then you assign the value with the create function. And we transformed all functions so that they return the fence for you. So returning the fence is a little bit tricky because, yeah, before we return the error value, and the question is what happened to the error value. And so we added by default Vulkan, the Vulkan C++ API throws exceptions. So in Vulkan, if there's an error, it's critical usually, and we want people to check for errors or catch them, because if you don't catch an error in Vulkan, you're lost. And yeah, usually you want to write your code like generate 50 objects, try catch, and if something in between goes wrong, you don't want to continue the code path in most cases. So what you do is you write try, put on all your code, catch, and if anything goes wrong, you have to destroy your objects you have created up to this place. But yeah, you don't have to care for ever checking each line anymore. And yeah, sometimes people don't want to use exceptions. So who likes them? Who doesn't like them? So is four exceptions? Oh, one person. No. Yeah, so since some people can't use exceptions because the compiler doesn't support them, there's a define Vulkan HPP no exceptions. If you set this one, we do return some special struct which contains the error value and the new created object. And yeah, you can use this result value and non-compress it, for example, with stdtie. Or on C++17, you can just write auto braces and put the two values inside and you're done. But yeah, usually you should try to use the exception version because this way you can't ignore errors. So how does the code look like after all those transformations? So before you had to create your fence, you had to create your create info, and then you could call, yeah, well, create my fence with this information and assert that there was no error. Yeah, in C++, it's now a single line of code. So you just say create my fence. The braces are for empty flex, a null pointer for the locator, and you try to catch the error. And since you catch the error for a bigger block, it's really like a single line of code out of four lines of code before. Yeah, the next interesting part is arrays as parameter input. So in C++, you have multiple ways to store errors in your code, and we wanted to support as much as possible. So for example, look at a scissor, at the set scissor function. Yeah, you want to pass a count and a pointer, and yeah, sometimes it's just one. Sometimes you might have 10 scissors, and you have to initialize them somehow in the code. And so we decided that we replace all functions which accept a count and a pointer by some array proxy, which accepts different types of arrays as input and just passes them to Vulkan. So for example, you can now write set scissor with this initializer lists and just pass the rectangle directly because it's just a single one. Also quite convenient. So you have the offset, you have the extent, and both together make up a rectangle. And so everything else was an std vector. Today it will be an initializer list. Those are slightly older slides. So this way, yeah, the count and the real data size is always correct. So you can't mix up an array of size 2 and pass an account of size 10. The lifetime of this temporary is exactly the time of the function call, so you can't pass data which is invalid at calling time. And so it's way safer and way more short. And those are all the types we support. So you can pass in an empty list, which means I don't want to pass any values. You can pass in just a null pointer, which is equivalent to an empty list. You can pass just a single element, which is an element of count of 1. You can pass a normal pointer count, if you have data from your external library, you can, if you pass just braces and multiple objects, it will automatically generate an initializer list, which has no runtime overhead at all. Or if you have built up an std vector, you can parse it with your custom allocator, or you can create an pass an std array if you have decided for this data structure. And all of those values are handled with a single array proxy object in between, so that we don't have an explosion in the interface. The first version had two functions, std vector and count pointer, and if we would have added all combinations, the header would be so big that it doesn't work. One of the last topics I want to talk about today are enumerations or queries. So if you want to query some values in Vulkan, most of the code I've seen creates an std vector and some count, and then you call Vulkan, tell me how much elements am I going to get from you? And Vulkan says, yeah, you get Q count elements. So you resize your vector, you query the data, and in fact, the loop is more complicated because if the Q count changes in this call, you have to do the same thing again, which is possible in theory. And the short version is, you just tell Vulkan, give me a vector of all Q family properties. Since the code is always the same and we can identify all functions which return an enumeration, we generate code which does all the stuff for you. So everything which is queried goes through some std vector return value. You're also allowed to use the old version, but who wants to use the complex code if there's a simple one? I'm nearly done. Okay, this is the loop again with the while loop. So let's skip it. One last thing, if you're updating buffers, you have also, this is one case in the API where you pass a device size and a pointer. And you have to pass in the correct values, you have to multiply the size and so on. And for this case, we also have an update buffer function, which gets an std vector of type t. This one will statically assert that size of t is a multiple of 4, which is not working in all of your cases, but it ensures that you are passing always a valid size to Vulkan, because those updates has to be a multiple of 4 from the size. If your type is not a multiple of 4, you have to use the normal version, which is also available. And last slide. You might have seen on one of the slides this conversion function from some flags to the output, where we check, okay, is this flag set append something to the string? We have generated two string functions for each and every enum and for flags. So you just call to string on any flex or any enum, and you get a string back. You get a string. You can use for stdc out or ostreen or whatever. This is just for convenience. So if you call it on 2 bits, you get a string with both bits and an or in between. And those are the basics of Vulkan HPP. And you can get them on the Kronos website, or they are included in the Vulkan SDK since version 1.0.24. Yeah, questions? Oh, we don't have time. No. Ask me later. Yeah.